Hello students, welcome back. So in yesterday's class we have seen about your time division multiplexing. Along with that one we have also seen the adaptive delta modulation. That was complete your first unit. So I hope you are all clear with the first chapter, and I also hope that you people have maintained the notes and you are not having any kinds of doubt in that first chapter. In case of any doubts, ma'am, please do let me know. Now in today's class I'm going to start your second unit, that is your information theory and source coding. This is one of the interesting chapter of your digital communication. Like all others are also interesting, but yes, it's somewhat problematic, so it will be bit interesting for your paper. First chapter was all about your theory, where we have seen pulse code modulation techniques, right? So before we move on to that one, I'll just revise what you have seen in the first chapter. That is your pulse code modulation techniques, right? In that one again we have also seen about the elements of your digital communication, the block diagram of that one, how you are going to convert your analog communication or the analog signals into digital signals, what are the steps, how you are converting A to D, like sampling, quantizing and encoding, right? Then afterwards we have seen what are different kinds of pulse code modulation, and we have pulse code modulation, then we had DPCM, differential pulse code modulation, right? Then we have the delta modulation and adaptive delta modulation. So we had some different types of drawbacks we have seen, and has to overcome all that one, how we have used different modulation techniques, pulse code modulation techniques we have also seen. Along with that one we have also seen the compounding methods. What actually is compounding? It is nothing but compression and expansion, okay? And we have seen different kinds of compounding, like A compounding and MOOC compounding. The topics I'm just revising so that you people will get an idea of what we have all discussed in the first chapter. Then at the last we have seen about the time division multiplexing, and very importantly we have seen the errors which we have got into the delta modulation, that is slope overload and granular noise. You might expect a question of per 2 marks, what is slope overload or a granular noise, and for short answers you may also get compounding. What is compounding? What are different kinds of compounding for 2 marks, as well as for the long answer, 5 marks or 10 marks also. Okay, so that are the important questions that you may you can expect in that one. Along with that one you also get the modulation demodulation techniques, important questions like what is PCM modulation, demodulation, DM, ADM and DPCM. You might be getting all this, so you have to draw transmitter as well as the receiver. Along with that one, why we have gone for the suppose an examiner asks write up briefly explain about adaptive delta modulation. So you have to clearly explain him about why you have gone for the adaptive delta modulation, like what are the steps, what are the things that you have added in your transmitter, like it will be using a logic step size control, you will be sending one by one steps or one signal per one sample per second, something like that. You have also added delay over there. You have to explain it clearly on the transmitter part as well as the receiver part, and which disadvantages it is overcoming, fine, and what are the advantages in case if there is an error, how you are going to overcome that one also, and application. So this is how you have to explain clearly for if you get a long answer question, correct? And you also might expect a questions like comparison between all the pulse code modulation techniques. You had 4 pulse code modulation techniques: PCM, DPCM, DM and ADM. You can also write that one. I'll be sharing you the notes. In that notes I have clearly mentioned the comparisons of all different pulse code modulation techniques. I'll show you that one once. So here you can see clearly I have given a comparison of different coding techniques that you are having, that is your pulse code modulation, differential pulse code modulation, then delta modulation and adaptive delta modulation. How for how many number of bits you are using, how many number of labels or step size you are using, then you can also say what is the quantization error or the distortions that you have got in different types of modulations, what is the transmission bandwidth you require, what is the feedback and complexity, right? So these are the comparisons of all these ones. Might expect, but not sure, but you might expect this question for the 4 marks, okay, or 5 marks, or else you can also get any two points to compare any 2 points between all 4 modulation techniques for 2 marks also. So that I hope you are all clear with this one. And very importantly, signal to noise ratios that we have found, that are also very important in this first chapter. What is the signal to noise ratio expression for the delta modulation that we have discussed? Okay, so these are the important questions that you may expect in the first chapter. I hope you are all clear with this one. Now let's move on to our next unit, that is your information theory and source coding. By the name itself, you can understand what is information. Can anyone explain what might be information? I'll give question in your Google form. You can answer there. Okay. What I'm going to tell, leave that one, and by your own tell me what actually information is. Okay, I'll just give a small question in the Google form, and let's see how many students will answer. But anyhow, if the students listen, okay, we'll see. So what we are going to discuss in your second topic, I'll just read it out, the topics what we are going to see here. So I'll be going to discuss what are the main important topics in your information theory and source coding. In that one, first we'll be going to see about uncertainty, the information and entropy, source coding, and you'll be having what are the techniques, how we are going to find out the errors and all by using a problematic method, a mathematical method is there, which is very famous and very important, that is Shannon Fano and Hamming coding will be there. Then afterwards, you will also see how many binary symmetric channels will be there, how you will be using that one. Okay, so this Shannon Fano coding, how you got and how many theorems you are having in that one, that we will be seeing in your unit 3. So before we go on in deep into this information theory, why actually we go for the information theory and source coding? Means information, whatever I'm speaking, this is the information that is transmitted through a particular channel, it is received by you people, right? So all this information, whatever I'm speaking, should be errorless, smoothly, it should be reaching to the receiver, right? So as to have this proper performance, this system or information should be transmitted without any errors, means it should be errorless. So that's the reason we are going to study about the information theory. What is the information, how we are going to convert, are there any errors in that one, how we will be mitigating or removing that errors, and how you can expect this errorless transmission, that we will be seeing in information theory. And source coding is nothing but how you can code that particular information and remove all the errors, and you can smoothly transmit your data to the receiver through a particular channel, right? So the performance of the communication system is measured in terms of error probability. As I've already said, like if your communication system is good and enough, means you have to see there is no error. So as to know that there is no error, you have to go for the error probability. Like how much is error probability? Suppose if you got 99% of good result, then you can say that error probability was only 0.1. If your error probability is 5.50 or something, then you can say that there is so much of error, so that the receiver cannot get the what actual data has been transmitted. Fine. So as to get the proper performance of the communication system, it has to be measured in terms of the error probability. So an errorless transmission is possible only when the probability of error at the receiver will be approaching zero. Yes. So an errorless transmission is possible when your probability of the error at the receiver will be approaching it to zero. So your complete communication system is good enough and you have transmitted all the data without any errors. When your probability of the error of P of X or P of E or something, whatever if you can define, so that will be reaching to zero, then we can say that your whole communication system, the performance of your communication system is very good enough, right? So I'll repeat it once again. An errorless transmission is possible when the probability of the error at the receiver approaches to the zero. Fine. Now let's see what is an actually information. Okay. So if I consider what is an information, whatever I'm speaking, this data is converted into digital form and given to the receiver, and receiver is nothing but your people. So whatever I'm teaching, that is your information, and that part is converted and given at the receiver side. So if we consider like example, consider the communication system which is transmitting the messages M1, M2 and M3, so on up to M1. with the probabilities P1, P2 and P3. So the amount of information that is transmitted through the message MK with the probability PK is given as IK is equals to log 2 of 1 by PK bits. So what actually this is IK is the information which is present in the message. Okay, whatever the information is present in the message is to be calculated. That is very important. I have sent you the message. For example, I have texted, I have recorded something in the WhatsApp and we have texted you people. You got a message. What is the notification that you will be getting? You got a message. When you open that recording, if there is nothing in that one, it means there is no information. So how you will be knowing that information is there is not in your particular message? So by using this formula, you can find it out what information is there in the message. Okay, I hope you are all clear with the what actually information is. So whatever the content which is present in the message, okay, and along with that one, the probability of that one also. So that is what we call as the information. So if you consider a communication system which transmits the message M1, M2 or M3 with its probabilities like P1, P2, P3, then the amount of information that is transmitted through the message signal with the probability of PK is given as information IK is equals to log 2 of 1 by probability of the message. That number of bits have been transmitted, means that number of information bits are present in the message. Clear? Now let's see the properties of the information, which are very important. There are four properties of the information, so we'll see one by one. You can also explain or derive these properties separately. You might also expect the 2 marks question like what is define information and write 2 properties of the information here. So very first property is that if there is more uncertainty of the message, then the information carried is also more. So if there is more uncertainty of the message, then the information carried is also more. Now what is meant by uncertainty? Uncertainty is nothing but the average information that is present in the message. Okay, if there is more average information of the message, that information carried is also more. Okay, so that's what we call, if there is more uncertainty of the message, information carried is also more. Okay, I'll explain about in case if you are having any doubt regarding your uncertainty, please do let me know. I'll explain again clearly in the next class. Okay, uncertainty is nothing but the average information of your message. So if there is average, if you know that there is some average information of that message, then obviously the overall information which is carried is also more. So because the very first property is that if there is more information of the message, information carried is also more. That is your first property. Now comes to the second property where you will be what you can say, we'll be deriving these equations also. If the receiver knows the message being transmitted, the amount of information carried is zero. This by yes or no? So whatever the receiver knows, whatever the information I'm transmitting, obviously the information will be zero. So this is the information, the receiver, if the receiver knows the message being transmitted about the amount of information carried is zero. Of course, yes or no, ma? I hope you are clear with this point and repeat it once again. See, whatever the content today I'm going to teach you people, you already know that this is the topic that ma'am is going to teach. Then what is the information there? That is zero, because you already know the information content what I'm going to tell. You already know the information what I'm transmitting through that particular message. Yes. So if the receiver already knows the message what it is being transmitted, so the amount of information will be obviously zero. Okay, so this is the second property of the information. Then the third property comes is, if I1 is the information carried by the message M1, okay, then I2 is the information carried by the message M2, then the amount of information carried by the both the messages can be given as summation of your first information and second information, right? So that will be equals to I1 plus I2. So if the information is the information of the first message is I1 and the information of the second message is I2, then the overall information carried by both the messages is given as I1 plus I2. Now, the last and fourth property, if there are m is equals to 2 to the power of n equally likely messages. I'll repeat, if there are m is equals to 2 to the power of n equally likely messages, means suppose the bit size is 10, okay, 10 is a bit size, so I'll be equally likely means 101010 messages I'll be getting. Okay, this is transmitting because you will be using digital data here. Equally likely, you have to, equally likely means you, 5 ones and 5 zeros should be there. So that is we call equally likely. So if there are m is equals to 2 to the power of n equally likely messages, then the amount of information carried by each message is n bits. Okay, so amount of information is, which is carried by each message is n bits. So these are the four properties of your information. And what is the probability of your information? Ik is equals to log 2 of 1 by pk bits. This is very important. Please do by heart this one. Okay, now let's just see one problem regarding this. A source producer, okay, a transmitter type. A source producer one of four possible symbols during each interval having the probabilities of p of x1 is equals to 1 by 2, p of x2 is equals to 1 by 4, p of x3 is equals to 1 by 4 and p of x4 is equals to 1 by 8. These are the four probabilities. What are the four probabilities? It means you will be having your messages, you are transmitting the messages m1, m2, m3, m4. Nothing but x1, x2, x3 and x4 are the four messages whose probabilities are given as p of x1, p of x2 and p of x3, p of x4. And these are the four probabilities. Okay, four possible symbols during each interval. Now obtain the information content of each of the symbols. Now tell me what is the information formula? That is nothing but ik is equals to log 2 of 1 by pk. What are the pk we have got? P of x1 is equals to 1 by 2, P of x2 is equals to 1 by 4, P of x3 is equals to 1 by 4 and P of x4 is equals to 1 by 8. We have taken this. Now your formula, you already know the formula. Now what it is saying, obtain the information content of each of the symbols. So separately you have to find out the information of each probability of the symbol. So what is the first one? Ik or the I1 I can consider. P of x1 is nothing but I1. So I1 is equals to log 2 of 1 by pk. What is the 1 by pk1? This is 1 by pk1. What is P of x1? 1 by 2. So log 2 of 1 by 1 by 2, that is equals to log 2 of 2, that is equals to I1 is equals to 1. Correct? Now I am going to find, because we are going to find each of the symbols separately, so I am finding the next one. I2 is equals to log 2 of 1 by 1 by 4. Now again you have to find it out and you will be finding log 2 of log 2 square, then you will be getting 2 value. Similarly I3 you have to find it out and lastly you have to go for I4. Okay, so this is how you are going to find it out. So I hope you are clear with this problem. Just see once again. I'll stop it here for 2 seconds. If you want to note it down, please do note it. Given information is this. Just you have to take the given values, probability values, and individually you have to find the information. If you calculate any one, easily you can get this one. Fine. Now see the next problem, which is very important. I have given the note also over here because as to get the clear idea about this one. See the problem. Calculate the amount of information if the binary digits occur with equal likelihood in the binary PCM system. This is the property which we have discussed there. Okay, in the what which property, third or fourth property, we have seen that if we are having likely messages, then the amount of information carried will be equals to n, like whatever that we have got. So we have, now we have to find out the amount of information if the binary digits occur with the equal likelihood in the binary PCM system. What you have to find it out? Information, same ik value you have to find out, but you got no values over here. You didn't got any probability values like here, right? You just didn't got anything. You have only one equation, that is equal likelihood. Now in PCM system we have only two probabilities of occurrence, yes, either 0 or either 1, because it is digital formula. We are coding over here, pulsed code method. Okay, so in pulse code modulation, what you have to do, ma? We have only two probabilities of occurrence, either 1 or 0. So the probability of occurrence is in overall 1, we can expect it as 1 by 2. So probability of occurrence of 1 is 1 by 2 and probability of occurrence of 0 is also 1 by 2. So we will be getting as P of x1 is equals to 1 by 2 and P of x2 is also 1 by 2. Because we are having only two probabilities of occurrence, 1 and 0. If overall probability we have to consider for 1, obviously half of the probability, 1 by 0, 1 half of the probability. So P of x1, first probability of getting the information 1 is 1 by 2 and probability of getting the information as 0 is another 1 by 2. So we have to find out the information, the amount of information for P of x1 is equals to 1 by 2 and P of x2 is equals to 1 by 2. So you will be getting as 1. Hence the binary digit in the PCM code is carrying 1 bit of information. Okay. So this is the conclusion that hence the binary digit in the pulse code modulation system is carrying 1 bit per information. Fine. I hope you are clear with the second one. Okay. Just write it down here. So shall I move on to the next one? Now see the third problem that is related to your property also. If there are m equally likely and independent symbols. Now big concentrate here. Equally likely independent symbols, then prove that the amount of information carried by each symbol will be n bits. Okay, this is the property that we have discussed. Okay, if they are equally likely bits, n is equals to 2 to the power of n, then we will be having the total information of bits will be n. So that you have to prove over here. So what is the probability of occurrence? P of x, that is equals to 1 by m, correct? So now what is the m value you are having here? 2 to the power of n. Now go to the your information formula. Ik is equals to log 2 of 1 by pk. What is pk? 1 by 2 to the power of n. So substitute that value of pk over here. Then you will be getting the answer as log 2 of 2 to the power of n. And you know the formula n log 2 square of n. So you will be getting this log 2 of log 2 to the power of 2, that is equals to 1. So your pik information is equals to n. So that is hence proved. We can say that the amount of information carried by each symbol will be equals to n bits when the condition is that m equally likely and independent symbols have been transmitted. So the information will be n bits. So this is how you have proved the fourth property. Now see the second property that we have seen. Here it is stated that the receiver knows the message. That means only one message is transmitted and the probability of occurrence of this message will be P of x is equals to 1. So if P of x is equals to 1, what is the information that you will be carrying? Log 2 of 1 by pk is 1 by 1. So 1 by 1 will be equals to log 2 of 1 is equals to 0. So the information what you have already known to the receiver, then the information will be 0. So this is the second property that we have proved. What is the second property, ma? I'll take you to the people to there. See here, if the receiver knows the message which is being transmitted, the amount of information carried is 0. Now don't get confused in this one on that one. Here we are saying that calculate the amount of information if they are equally likelihood. Equally likelihood means you will be having the probability of 1s and 0s. But what we are saying in this property, it is stated that receiver already knows. It means either 1 has transmitted, either 0 has transmitted. Only one information has been transmitted. So occurrence has already done. So that means only one message is transmitted. Okay, because we know that only one message is transmitted and the probability of occurrence of this one message is P of x is equals to 1 or P of k is equals to 1. So therefore we can say that the amount of information carried by this type of message will be given as 1 by so log 2 of 1 by pk, that is 1 by 1. So log 2 of 1 is equals to 0. So the amount of information is equals to 0. So I hope you are all clear with this properties and all. Yes. Now just see the last property or the last example that we are going to see here, that the information given by first message and the second message will be equals to I1 plus I2 that we have seen, no? The fourth property. Let's move on to that property here. If there are messages, this one. if I1 is the information carried by message M1 and I2 is the information carried by message M2, then the amount of information carried by both the messages will be equals to I1 plus I2. Correct? Now we have to see here about this. What is that? We have to see separately what is the information you are getting. Yeah. If I of X1 is the information carried by the symbol X1 and I2 is the information carried by the symbol X2, then prove that the amount of information carried compositely due to X1 and X2 will be equals to I of X1 plus I of X2. Correct? This is the property of your information also. Now see, the amount of information is expressed as I of X1 is equals to log 2 of 1 by P of X1. And I of X2 is equals to, we usually had IK is equals to log 2 of 1 by PK. Now we are just having the whatever that we have given the suffix value that we are substituting over here. So I of X2 is equals to log 2 of 1 by PX2. Now here P of X1 is the probability of the symbol X1 and P of X2 is the probability of the symbol X2. And these both symbols are independent with each other. So they are independent. So the probability of composite messages is P of X1 and P of X2. So we are having the compositability. So we will be having the product term. So P of X1 into P of X2. Now what we'll be doing? So I of X1 comma I of X2 is equals to log 2 of 1 by P of X1 into P of X2. Now we have what log a into b. So what is the formula that you will be given? Log a into b is equals to log a plus log b. What is a? This is P of X1 is a and P of X2 is b. Okay. Now we can write this one as, not this part. So log 2 of 1 by P of X1 plus log 2 of 1 by P of X2. Now log 2 of 1 by P of X1 is I1. The information I1. Okay, and log 2 of 1 by P of X2 is information I2. So here we can say that whatever the information which is carried by symbol carried by symbol X1 and the information carried by symbol X2, can they both be compositely gathered together. So we can get I of X1 comma X2 is equals to I1 plus I2. Correct? I hope you are clear with this property also. I'll repeat it once again. If they are independent and probability is composite, then you can write it as P of X1 into X2. So this is not the correct manma. I have striked it out. So log 2 of 1 by P of X1 into 1 by P of X2 you can write. So that the formula you can make it as log A into log B. And that log A B formula is equals to log A plus log B. So this log 2 of 1 by P of X1 is equals to I1 and log 2 of 1 by X2 is equals to I2. So I of X1 comma I of X2 is equals to I1 plus I2. So what is the property that we have proved here? If I1 is the information carried by message M1 and I2 is the information carried by message M2, then the amount of information carried by both the messages will be I1 plus I2. Hence proved. So I hope you are clear with this information and the four properties of this information. Please write down in the notes, practice well. Okay, so in case of any doubts, ma, please do let me know. Okay, so I'll wind up the class here itself. Thank you.